Welcome back. We're here to do a reflection on the 18th week in Ordinary Time. We may have mentioned before that we're in year B. We have A, B, C years that go from Advent to Christ the King, which is the last week of the year and usually at the end of, well, it's almost always at the end of November, right before the first week of Advent. So we are continuing on with the sixth chapter of John's Gospel, which gives to us some of the most rich and wonderful readings in all of the New Testament. It's where Jesus announces the Eucharist, and it's profound. And I'll just, risk of going on and on and on before we start, I'll stop and we'll have Teresa read from the sixth chapter of John's Gospel.
A reading from the Holy Gospel according to John. When the crowd saw that neither Jesus nor his disciples were there, they themselves got into boats and came to Capernaum looking for Jesus. And when they found him across the sea, they said to him, "Rabbi, when did you get here?" Jesus answered them and said, "Amen, amen, I say to you, you are looking for me not because you saw signs, but because you ate the loaves and were filled. Do not work for food that perishes, but for the food that endures for eternal life, which the Son of Man will give you. For on him the Father God has set his seal." So they said to him, "What can we do to accomplish the works of God?" Jesus answered and said to them, "This is the work of God, that you believe in the one he sent." So they said to him, "What sign can you do that we may see and believe in you? What can you do? Our ancestors ate manna in the desert, as it is written, 'He gave them bread from heaven to eat.'" So Jesus said to them, "Amen, amen, I say to you, it was not Moses who gave the bread from heaven. My Father gives you the true bread from heaven. For the bread of God is that which comes down from heaven and gives life to the world." So they said to him, "Sir, give us this bread always." Jesus said to them, "I am the bread of life. Whoever comes to me will never hunger, and whoever believes in me will never thirst." The Gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, Lord Jesus Christ. So we have this very profound continuation from last week's Gospel, where he multiplied the loaves and the fishes for the 5,000 plus people who were there with him. And again, the effect of this sacrament is astonishing. It's kind of like something heavy just hits the ground and everything vibrates. It has that kind of effect, it's resonant. It spreads and it's kind of wow. It's a terrible understatement, but you understand that it's an amazing event. And we remember that he flees because they're going to make him king. Because you understand that someone who could provide for us in this way, bread and fish in this way, we really would be a great king, someone who can do this for us as often as we're hungry. Jesus rather uses this as a sign of another kind of life. Okay, I've fed your bodies, you're satisfied, but the bread I give you, the bread that the Son of Man will give you, you will consume and it won't be used up in the using. It will well up in you. You will never be hungry. You will never thirst. And that is an astonishing thought in and of itself. But it's the basis and it's the announcement of the Eucharist in the sense that I am the bread of life. Now, bread had sustained this culture for centuries. And fish in the place in the world, the fish were a primary source of food, and his ability to do this, it's a beautiful and amazing sign of the Eucharist, that I am the bread of life. That saying I'm the bread of life for Jesus is saying that that bread which is already a gift of God, which is already holy. There's a new bread. There's a higher bread. We're not just looking at our own earthly horizon. We're looking above it. We're looking into heaven. And we're being taught by him that we're called to live also in that life. Here we have eternal life. And eternal life, really, the older I get and the more I think about the word eternal, the less I think of time, the less I think of forever. Sometimes, well, eternal means forever. Well, we say things like that. Oh, God, that meeting was eternal. You know, it was just went on and on and on forever. Well, that's a very poor use of the word eternal. Eternal is much more of a... I'll interchange it when it's appropriate, when I'm doing these videos, for example, with divine. I'll say divine life, eternal life, so that you get not only a ongoing sense of the word eternal, but a round sense of the word divine, eternal. So it talks about the fullness of my life. When I hear the word eternal now, I don't think of a line continuing like a timeline. I think of a sphere, something that's full and round and complete, not something that's unending. And that's really the wrong way, I think, to look at it. So, but our eternal life is one that's full, and it starts now. It's not only later. We tend to think about it. We're here in time, and then we go to eternity. We say that all the time. When we go to eternity, we'll be this or this. But time and eternity are woven together here, because heaven and earth have come together in Jesus Christ. So, and in the Eucharist especially, our churches and our holy places where we celebrate the Mass always have with us a representation that's very similar to what we see when we look out over one of the Great Lakes or the Finger Lakes or something, or a beautiful river. You see the earth and water on the ground. You see the sky above. There's a wonderful aria that starts that way in Italian, cielo e mar. It's just the sky and sea. You can see it and they come together. Our church's sky, cielo, means heaven in Italian, and sky. And nebo in Polish, and so on and so forth. Anyway, so you have the sky. Our mural here at St. Mary's is angels and the Blessed Mother and the coronation and the Assumption of Mary. In the sky, and then in the bottom, we have wood and stone and marble and all of those earthly things, because heaven and earth have come together right on that altar where we celebrate the Mass every weekend. And it's a beautiful thing, beautiful, beautiful coming together. We see in our earthly life when horizon meets sky meets and the horizon meets the earth, that amazing representation of what's happening in Jesus Christ. And that's really what it is. We rebuild that and recreate that in our churches to teach the same thing. In our sanctuary here, above it, it's that great line from the beginning of John's Gospel. And he says to Nathanael, "You will see heaven open and the angels of God ascending and descending on the Son of Man." Also describing that same thing to Nathanael, as Jesus says earlier in John's Gospel. You're going to see greater things than this. You'll see heaven open. Heaven open. And the angels of God coming and going on this earth, on the Son of Man. Great, great, beautiful, beautiful also image of that. And our learning here that Jesus is really working very hard to direct us to is toward that, toward there's something more than past our field of vision on this earth. We're made for something more, and we are invited to participate in it. And participate is exactly the right word. We participate in the Mass. We participate in the life of God in our faith. And that's what we're being called to. Any discussion of the Eucharist has to include this word participate. Communion, we're coming together, communion. If it doesn't include that thinking, it's very insufficient to what it is. The Eucharist is a verb, it's an action, and that action is a partaking of us, of the life of God himself, so that we may be made one in him. I was thinking about this the other day, but when, you know, some of you know that I'm always kind of watching boxing and thinking about boxing, especially the old-timey boxing. I'm not much of a boxing historian, but I like what I know and what I have time to look at. But I was recently watching a very interesting thing about George Foreman. Now, if you don't know anything about George Foreman, and I'll be brief because I could probably do two videos on this and still make it relevant to what we're talking about, which is good. It's always a plus. But George Foreman is, many of you know if you were alive in the 90s or even later, he's the smiling face that sold the George Foreman grill that was everybody in the world had in the 90s. And he was smiling, extremely pleasant, extremely affable, likable, delightful person, laughing, and big, they call his nickname is Big George Foreman. It's a pretty basic nickname, but it's right. He was a great big man. But some of you don't realize is that he became the oldest man to win the heavyweight title at 45 in 1994. And some of you may not even know that he had lost it in 1974. He had held the title in 1974 and lost in one of the greatest sporting events in the last 100 years ago to Muhammad Ali in what was then called Zaire, now the Congo. It was an astonishing event. But he was a young guy. Muhammad Ali was older than he was. But George Foreman, when he was young, was a menacing, intimidating, scary, powerful boxer. He was frightening. Frighteningly strong person, very, very powerful, and won a gold medal after only having really only boxing for like 1 year, won the gold medal in the Olympics, and then came out of that of amateur boxing into professional boxing and didn't lose until he lost to Muhammad Ali. So he was this menacing persona as a boxer. He had this, and he was terrifying to people. And everybody thought he would beat Ali very easily. But when he lost, he said he was so embarrassed, and he came up with all kinds of excuses, and he tried to get back to being that frightening person that he was before. He tried to get back to that. And he did all kinds of crazy things, and he was strong man. And he had a few other fights, and a few years after the Ali fight in 1974, he fought Jimmy Young, and he lost it in a decision. And he was in the dressing room, and something happened to him. He was having some kind of weird religious experience. He later said he wasn't religious at all. He didn't believe in any of this. And he kind of passed out in the dressing room after the fight. And when he came to, he saw blood on his hands, and he says, "Jesus Christ is coming alive in me," when he saw the blood on his hands. It's an astonishing thing, and he even says it. You can find the videos on YouTube, but he says, "I didn't believe any of this," when he said it, that Jesus Christ is coming alive with me. He quit boxing after that, and he said he didn't make a fist for 10 years. And he became a preacher and an ordained minister in 1979. And he didn't think about boxing, didn't do anything with boxing, really, for 10 years. He went around preaching, and he says, I'm an evangelist. That's really what I do. He had a church in Houston, Texas, where he's from. And all of a sudden, this transformation comes about. Well, 10 years later, he has 10 children, and five of them are boys, five of them are girls, and all of the boys are named George, and apparently some of the girls are named George too, but you can learn more about that on your own. But he needed money. He needed money for his family, he needed money for his youth center, he needed money for all these things. So he went back to boxing, and everyone made fun of him and said this, he's desperate and all that stuff. And he won. A few years later, he won, and he stood in the ring, he took the guy who he fought in the to gain the title was 19 years younger than he was, and he did something to him very similar to what Ali had done to him those 20 years. Okay, now, so not to go on and on, but George Foreman starts off this one way, and this is a modern example of this, And he ends up another way. He ends up this affable, lovable, amazing human being who made peace with the people he thought Ali had cheated. He did this, and he became best friends before Ali died. And he made peace and became one of the great people in our American culture nowadays. And what a testimony to the power that the Holy Spirit works within us. What a testimony to the word repent, which I've best definition and the best understanding I can give you is to turn around. And in our world today, do you not notice that how often we say tigers never change their stripes? Well, once this way, always this way. People don't change. People, you know, as far as I'm concerned, and you hear Catholics, you hear Christians, you hear people say those things. Meanwhile, our tradition is built on stories like this one about George Foreman, because it happened to St. Paul, it happened to Augustine, it happened to whatever, it goes on and on and on and on and on. It's built on the idea that that's what we're called to, that we're called to not only be the masters of this world, like the young George Foreman thought, but masters of or participants in a bigger world. Remember Jesus' great saying, what does it profit you if you gain the whole world but lose your soul in the process? What does it profit us? What? And that's really, really central to this. He's desperately trying us to get us to realize that we're more than we are now. We're all tadpoles looking up at the surface of the water, saying, either saying, "I want to get out there and see what's up there," or, "Don't be foolish. There's nothing up there." We're all in that position. That's a Fulton Sheen thing, by the way, too. I didn't want to not have a quote of his. But we're all in that position where we have to make that choice. And it has to do also with turning around. What kind of life do I want? Do I want one where I'm blaming everybody else for all of my problems? Do I want one where I'm constantly looking and saying, oh, if they only did this for me, I'd be this? Constantly licking our wounds and self-pitying ourselves for good or for ill. You might be right, you might be wrong about it. But is that the kind of life that you want for yourself? Or do you want eternal life? Do you want a share in the divine life? Do you want to be a participant with God in that life of faith that we profess? That God has put a seal on Jesus Christ. And by the way, to put a seal, you know, bread used to get a seal from the baker. On our hosts, we have a seal on it. And it was so that you knew who made it. When Jesus says this, it's talking about bread. I'm like bread because God has put his seal on me. He's saying bread, and bread had, again, sustained that culture for centuries. And what could, no, but I can sustain you for eternal life, for a share in the divine life. So thank you for allowing me to go down memory lane there with sports trivia, but it's a wonderfully illustrative story of what happens to us when Jesus Christ comes alive in us. Now, in our own lives, do we pray for that experience? Do we pray to be full and filled up? Do we pray at all? And it doesn't mean you get down and your knees and you say, okay, this. Do we talk to God? Do we talk out of our own heart? Your heart has challenges and problems unlike no one else's. Do we share them with God? Do we rather instead, when we think something, go, oh, Mike, be quiet, or whatever your name is, and be quiet, please get to yourself? Or do we go, hey, God, help me deal with this. It's bothering me that I'm thinking about things this way. Do we work on it? And when we fail, do we ask God to help us work on it for us? You can imagine that someone like George Foreman, when he lost, tried to explain away that loss for several years. But now, as a 71 or 2-year-old man, he looks back and says, I didn't like losing, but look where it's led me today. I'm paraphrasing what he said, of course. But that's the way it is. It is that God is working in us, and if it turns us into amazing people, then may it happen to us. May those challenges come. So, in thinking about the Eucharist, think about that. Thinking about that when we receive Jesus Christ, that we become members of his body, that we become him in the situations in the world that we encounter in our own lives. That by the power of the Holy Spirit, we're constantly being drawn back together, trying constantly being made one, constantly being drawn into the fullness of life in him. And that's what he does for us. That's what he offers us. And that's what he's announcing here. As we continue over these weeks, it's going to be important for us to build on that. And in a special way, maybe take a few moments this week and reflect on what a great life you've been called to. And if you don't feel that way, ask God for the grace. Help me to feel the fullness of your peace, of your joy, and of your love. So have a wonderful week. This one's a little longer. We won't make it a practice to go over too much, but I was thinking about that and I thought it would be a good illustration. So have a wonderful week and take good care.